Finances God's way. Everybody say God's way.
God's
way. Navigating your finances God's way. And we started last week and we had a great time. We learned that that God owns everything. Everything we have belongs to God. And that God's going to do his part. And God expects us to do our part. Today we're going to talk about the big D. The big D. Y'all know what that is?
Yeah.
Yeah, we're going to talk about debt. We're going to talk about debt before we get into the work. And so we're going to do the same thing we did last week. There's some short video clips. And then I will review the video clip. And then we will discuss it a little bit. Or I will give you some more commentary on it. And then we will invite anyone who doesn't have a relationship with Christ to start that relationship with Christ today. But here's what I want you to do. I need every family here today to commit to coming, being in regular attendance for the next 4 weeks as we go through this financial piece, because it is so important. I'm convinced that if we handle our finances the way the Bible teaches us, then all of our lives will be the better. How many of you are givers and tithers already? Givers and tithers already. You can talk to any one of these people. They will tell you that God keeps his promises. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Gracious God, our Father, we thank you today, and we thank you for the families that are here today who have come to hear your word. We pray, oh God, that you would bless my voice now, that I might be able to give your word. I pray that you would arrest the minds of those who are in the congregation today, that we might, you know, have a serious look at debt and what your word says about debt, and how you want us to handle our debt. I pray, oh God, if there's someone here today that does not have an authentic relationship with you, that they will hear the gospel and will come to you and begin a relationship with you, accepting you as their personal savior after having paid for our sins on the cross. Take my words and make them your words, that the world will see more of you and less of me. In Christ's name we pray, let all God's people say together, amen. Turn with me to Proverbs chapter 22. We're gonna read some scriptures this morning that you probably didn't know was in the Bible, or you have probably never read them in the Bible. And these are scriptures about debt and what the Bible says. This is gonna be our theme verse today. Look at what that says. Proverbs 22, verse 7. Proverbs 22, verse 7. So let's look at the screen and let's read it together. Ready? Read. The borrower is slave to the lender. That's some pretty tough language, isn't it? I mean, that is an indictment of sorts on all of us who have ever been in the situation of being a borrower. And if it's not an indictment, it's at least a revelation or a reminder that when you borrow, you pretty much are a slave to the lender. So there is no doubt, it is not up for discussion, it is not a theory, it is a fact that debt causes stress.
Yes, sir.
Say amen.
Amen.
Can you all witness to that? Debt causes stress. Now I'm gonna go out here on a limb. I don't think there's anyone here today that does not occupy some sort of debt. Student loans, mortgage, car, credit card of debt. And debt has the potential to create stress. Debt also has the potential to destroy relationships, including some marriages. How many married people? Now, I'm not leaving single folk out. If you're married, though, raise your hand today. How many of you would be a witness that money issues can bring stress to a marriage? I mean, things just ain't, when the money is low, amen. Amen, somebody. It's just a mess. I mean, when you're trying to pay the bills, where my brother's at? Brother, you're trying to work out the bills, and then you know she got that Nordstrom's card. Y'all ain't said nothing to me. Looking at my friend Chris over here. He got that Nordstrom car. You don't know what they're gonna do. You just say, where you at, baby? Oh, I'm at the mall. You just start praying. Where you going when you leave the mall? Well, I'm going by the nail place, and then I'm gonna go by the. I'm just saying it could cause some stress at the house when the money is out. You know, and I remember when I first moved here, I'm an avid golfer, and when I first moved here, I would go golfing, and we used to have, Benita and I used to have one account, and I'm going to talk about this money map, because you're supposed to have done that for homework. We used to have one account. Y'all pray for me as I get through this story. Because you know, everybody talks about your money is, your, how's it go? My money is your money. But her money was her money. No, her money. It's supposed to be all our money. Supposed to be all our money. And so we're going to get one account. One account. Everybody get their paycheck. Everybody deposit their money in the same account. And then we pay our bills. And then everything was cool. Everything was working out real good. Until I started golfing. And I was golfing, and I didn't know when I wanted to golf. I just golfed when I felt like it. On my lunch break, one week I golfed 6 times, next week I made 12 times. But there was a disturbance in my house about the amount of times I had been golfing. You know what I'm saying? And it confused me because I didn't understand why golfing was the issue, but Nordstrom's, well, anyway, so anyway, I'm just saying, it can mess up a marriage. It can really destroy a marriage. So if you're married, now if you're single, it can be tough too. Stress, debt can cause a stress. Many people use debt, watch this, use debt, get into debt to raise their standard of living. And in doing so, they begin to live, watch this, above their means. Everybody say above their means. You try to raise your standard of living by going into debt, and you're living above your means. You ain't got no business driving a BMW and parking it under the canopy at an apartment complex. Look at your neighbor and say, that made no sense. Buy a house. You don't even have a garage. You got a $67,000 car and don't even have a garage to, right, because you're profiling, trying to impress your friends. That's not living above your means. And here's the other thing. It's a lot easier to buy stuff. It's harder to keep it. See, I'm never impressed when folk get something. Because you can get stuff. The question is, can you keep it? And so a lot of us live outside of our means. Trying to impress people that we don't like and people that don't like us. So tap your neighbor on the shoulder and say, live within your means. Live within your means. So the decision to borrow is often based on the assumption that we will eventually earn enough to repay the debt. So I'm going to borrow because I'm going to eventually earn enough to repay the debt. But how do you know it's going to happen tomorrow? You may not have a job tomorrow. Your life can change in an instant. So you should always live and spend with caution. Understand that whatever we have, God has given it to us, and God will give us the ability of strength and of mind and of wisdom and our gifts and our talents to earn money, but we should never borrow with just a blind thought, I'm going to live long enough to pay it back, because it may not happen. You may not have a job. So just always be thinking about if things don't go exactly the way you have planned it. So what is debt? Money owed to credit cards, companies, bank loans, student loans, and money borrowed from relatives, like my brother. mortgages, and pass-through bills. Look at Romans 13. So before we go to Romans 13, let's look at this map. Go back. I hope everybody did their homework last week. Did you do your homework? How many of you figured out where you were on this money map? Raise your hand. Figured out where you were on this money map. Where you were on this money map. I talked to a couple of you. Some of you got, were doing pretty good. One and two, and then three kind of got you. Paid off all consumer debts. It's kind of a common place that people get stuck a lot. Paying off all the consumer debts, you know, auto and your student loan. Because I went on to school to get a graduate degree, a master's degree, and I was thinking that because I got a master's degree, I would automatically get a job that would help me pay off my student loans. Last time I looked at my balance, my student loans, it was like $86,000 for my master's degree. And I began to second guess, but maybe I shouldn't have done it. I don't want you to think like that. You have to trust God. So if you're on three, you just own three. Amen. Don't be embarrassed about where you are. Let's look at Romans 13 and 8. Look what it says. Another scripture about debt. Keep out of debt and owe nothing to no one. That's the Apostle Paul talking to the church at Rome. So let's look at the first video that talks about debt. Let's see what she has to say.
Let's face it, debt is a struggle for many of us. It often increases stress, which contributes to physical and emotional fatigue. It can stifle creativity and destroy relationships, even marriages. Many people use debt to raise their standard of living, only to discover that the burden of debt harms them. Debt includes money owed to credit card companies, bank loans, student loans, money borrowed from relatives, mortgages, and past due medical bills. Bills that come due, such as monthly electric bills, are not debt if they're paid on time. Well, it's clear that the Bible discourages debt. Romans 13:8 says, "Keep out of debt and owe nothing to anyone." In Proverbs 22:7, we learn why the Lord discourages debt. The borrower is slave to the lender. If you've been in debt, you know the feeling of this bondage. In the Old Testament, being out of debt was a reward for obedience. Deuteronomy 28 tells us, "If you diligently obey the Lord your God, being careful to do all his commandments, all these blessings shall come upon you. You shall lend to many nations, but you shall not borrow."
Amen.
On the other hand, debt was one of the curses for disobedience. Deuteronomy 28 says, "If you will not obey the Lord your God, all these curses shall come upon you. The alien who is among you shall rise above you higher and higher. He shall lend to you, but you shall not lend to him." The decision to borrow often is based on the assumption that we'll earn enough to repay the debt. We plan for our job to continue or our business or investments to be profitable. However, James 4:13-14 cautions us against this. "Come now, you who say, today or tomorrow we will go to such and such a city and spend a year there and engage in business and make a profit. Yet you do not know what your life will be like tomorrow." So if you're in debt, here's how to get out of it. First, pray. In 2 Kings 4:1-7, a widow was threatened with losing her children to a creditor, and she asked the prophet Elisha for help. He told her to borrow lots of empty jars from her neighbors. Then the Lord multiplied her only possession, a small amount of oil, and all the jars were filled. She sold the oil and paid her debts to free her children. The same God who provided for the widow is interested in you becoming debt-free. The second step is to create as much monthly surplus as possible, because the more your surplus, the quicker you can pay off debt. You do that by increasing your income or reducing expenses. It's that simple. So ask two questions about every expense. Do we need this? If so, can we do it less expensively? Some people have lowered their expenses significantly by making a radical change in their lifestyle to get out of debt more quickly. Some have sold their homes and moved to smaller ones, or rented apartments, or moved in with family. Others have sold cars with large monthly payments and have purchased inexpensive used cars for cash. They have temporarily lowered their cost of living to become debt-free. And don't forget to start using a budget if you're not already using one, because this will help you plan ahead and control impulse spending. We'll help you start one later in the study. Then think about how you can increase your income. What skills do you have that can produce more income? A part-time second job or working from home can make a huge difference in how quickly you can get out of debt. The key is to decide in advance to focus on paying off debts with the additional money that you earn. The third step is snowball your way out of debt. And here's how. In addition to making the minimum payments on all your debts, focus on paying off one debt at a time, starting with the one with the lowest balance first. Here's why. Getting out of debt can be hard, and we need to be encouraged by seeing the balance go down and finally to be paid off. After the first debt is paid off, apply its payment toward the next smallest one. After the second debt is paid off, apply what you were paying on the first and second debt toward the third smallest balance. And that's the snowball in action. If you're disciplined and are already making progress on paying off debt, you may choose to focus on paying off the higher interest rate debts first, even if the balances are larger.
Good stuff. Isn't that good stuff, isn't it? Just practical stuff. Now, here's the problem with a lot of church people and spiritual people. They don't know how to be practical. They're so deep and so saved that they're no good for the world. But I don't care how saved you are, you probably have a mortgage. And you can't go to the mortgage company and say and have a prayer meeting and say, accept that as my payment. So tell somebody, learn to be practical. So if you're going to get out of debt, first thing you got to do is you got to pray, Lord, deliver me from these bills. Got to console God. Pray and ask God. That's a sincere prayer. That is a logical prayer. It is a practical prayer. Ask God to deliver you from your debt through prayer. But I love the practical exercise suggestion she gives us. I hope we will all use it. She says, create as much surplus as possible by increasing your income, or, she says, or reducing your spending. The or is good, but I've also tried and increasing your income and reducing. That's what we've done. That's what we did at our church here. When we first got in our building, it was a challenge for us to meet a mortgage. And we're going to talk about when it's proper to have debt to meet our mortgage. The church was growing slowly, but I had a meeting and we decided, okay, we're gonna try to increase our income, meaning the partners and members and the tithes, by investing in them so they can see value in serving God and being a part of this particular church. And we're going to also at the same time reduce our expenses. And we did that. I took a cut, but Tim took a cut. Some of our other staff took a cut, and God began to bless us. So if you could do the and, it works even better as opposed to the or. The other thing that's not mentioned that I found to be very helpful is creating for yourself multiple streams of income. Don't give anybody the total keys to your success. You always want your employer to know, now I got a couple other things in my option bag. Y'all say amen. Because when people feel like you're their only source, or you know what I'm saying? They'll take advantage of you. And so it's not good professionally, but it's just not good personally. Try to create multiple streams of income, and that also help kind of get rid of debt. So ask two questions. She says, do I need it? I want to add, do I need it? And or do I need it now? Everybody say now. Because some stuff you need, but you might not need it now. You just don't need a 5-carat diamond. Nah, I know y'all need it, ladies, amen, but maybe not now. In fact, you may not ever need it, but make that distinction when you determine you need something. Ask yourself, do I need it, and do I need it now? Because learn to wait. My mom used to wait till they went on sale, but that's Lucille. But sometimes it's a value learning to wait to get on sale. Like this shirt was on sale, this polo is nice, ain't it? I saw this 2 weeks ago at one price. I said, I'm going to wait. I'm going to get it. I need it. Amen, somebody. God knows I need it. But I didn't need it I didn't need it now, right? So I waited. So do I need it now? If so, it's another good thing. Can you get it for cheaper? Can you wait? Get something less expensive. And we got to really discipline ourselves if we're going to get out of debt. And then use a budget. You can't run your finances with guessing unless you just got so much money you don't know what to do with it. You need a budget. And I think, and if you go to our small groups at 10:10, one of the things that we'll be doing with Pastor Ryan and Pastor Denise is you'll be doing your own budget. You'll be bringing it, get with your family or get with your spouse, or if you're single, get home at the kitchen table, put together a budget, have a plan. And that will help you know what you're spending and what you're spending it on. A lot of the banks now have software, online banking, and they will, if you pay your bills online, if you do everything online, at a click of a button, it will tell you exactly where your money's going. Now, I'm at the age, I'm 46, so I'm in the age where they taught us how to write a check in school. They might not even be doing that now because checks are they're outdated for a lot of people. But I'm one of those people that didn't like to balance a checkbook. I just hated it, it was just too much. Now you don't have to do that. If you bank online, they'll send you a text message or get a debit card. You know why I love the debit card? If you ain't got it. And it don't argue with you. You ain't got to go to no meeting or nothing. You swipe that, baby, if you ain't got it. If the item is $21.99 and you ain't got 20, I mean, even at the gas pump. I went to get gas one day. I got to get through this sermon. I got to tell you this funny story because I didn't know it would work like this. I went to get gas one day. I went to fill up my car. So I swiped my card, punched in what I wanted, and put the, you know, chose my unleaded, started pumping. I'm in my mind, I'm finna fill up my tank. And the little reader got to $7.06, and it shut off. So I said to myself, clearly there is a malfunction with y'all equipment. And so I went inside to protest and told the lady what had happened. She said, well, that's probably all you had. So debit cards, great. Debit cards keep you out of debt because you can only spend what you got. And then after that, $7 and whatever. Okay. The snowball thing is awesome. I've done this in my life, and I'm going to do this very quickly. Snowball. Pay the smallest bill first, the one with the least interest rate. Now, some advisors would tell you pay the one with the highest interest rate. But either way, pay one debt off at a time. The reason why you can't make any progress, you think you're going to pay them all off. If you could do that, then you wouldn't be in the problem in the first place. So pay the smallest one off first, the one with the least interest rate, and you'll begin to see yourself make progress. And then you'll feel good about having accomplished something. Is this helping anybody? I hope so. One bill at a time, and you can get through this. So snowball your way out. Begin with the one with the smallest balance so you can see results and be motivated to continue. All right, this next part, or this next section is about cars, automobiles. Right. Pay close attention to this. I won't, if two people walk out of here with a revelation about these cars, I'll feel like we had a good Sunday. Is that okay? That's fair? So maybe you'll be one of the two people. It's not long, this video is short. Let's see what it says about the car.
Now let's shift gears and talk about how you can get out of auto debt. First, pay off your automobile loan and then keep your car for at least 3 more years. Continue paying the car payment, but to yourself into your own savings account. Then, when you're ready to replace your car, the saved cash plus the trade-in should be enough to buy a reliable car without going into debt. Well, when can we owe money? Scripture doesn't address this, so let me give you our opinion. We believe it's possible to owe money for a home mortgage, your education, or business. But here's the rule of thumb for this debt. Borrow as little as possible and pay it off as quickly as possible. Try to become totally debt-free as soon as possible. The last issue related to debt is co-signing. A person who co-signs becomes legally responsible for the debt of another. Unfortunately, a study found that most co-signers end up making the payments. The Bible clearly discourages co-signing. Proverbs 17:18 reads, "It is poor judgment to co-sign another's note to become responsible for his debts." The words poor judgment are better translated destitute of mind. Listen carefully. When you co-sign, you pledge all your assets as collateral as long as the debt exists. Everything you own is at risk. May the Lord bless your efforts to pay off debt and become freer to serve Christ.
All right, pay off your loan, your car loan. And here's the kicker. And keep making payments to yourself for 3 years. So you got a 3-year car loan or a 5-year car loan, and you how many have ever paid off a car? You paid off your car, hallelujah. And you start feeling the Holy Ghost. You make those last 3-4 payments, you know it's coming up. So I'm almost done with this payment. And then you pay it off in November. Most of us, what we do, by January, we buy another car. The suggestion here is drive the car you just bought for a little bit, preferably 3 years, and make the payments, because you're already making them. You're already used to making them if you didn't get it repoed. That means you're making them, right? Pay yourself. Touch yourself. Say, pay yourself. We have to learn to pay ourselves. Now, I got 5 minutes. I'm trying to get through this quickly. Now, in a few weeks, we're going to be talking about investment, and those who are making a little more money, you're not in this type of bracket. You make a little more money, we're going to be talking about investment. But the concept is the same, whether you're making a little bit or a lot. Put some money away for yourself. Look at what you can do. Let's show the next slide. All right, let's say the average car payment is $450. Now, that's give or take. $450, and let's just say that's also insurance. That's kind of the average. So if you save $450 for 36 months, that's 3 years, pay yourself, you would have saved about $16,200. Now, if you put it in a simple interest account, I guess that's about 0.8%. Is that about right? 1% interest is not much, but it's free money. Somebody say free money. And I'm cool with free money. So even if you just do a simple, savings account, $16,200. All right? Let's say now you want to go buy a brand new Honda Accord. That's a 2016 Honda Accord. Now let me just help you out like this. You ain't got to always go buy the most expensive car in the world. Now, if you got it like that you got it like that. But if you don't, but do something sensible and reasonable. You can't eat your car and you can't sleep in your car. You can sleep in it, but not very comfortably. You don't want to sleep in it for 3 years, do you? Right? So, in my mind, and I don't, people's opinions are different. In my mind, a Honda Accord is a respectable mid-sized sedan. I mean, it's a nice car. Now, yeah, it's and reliable. It'll run forever. I used to own one, so I know it. So, that car costs $22,000. I just looked that on the internet the other day. $22,455. Now, if you've already saved $16,000, and then you got to trade in your hoopty. All right. You're going to get at least $1,500 if you can't get $1,500 for a 4, 5, 6 year car, then come talk to me. You don't know how to negotiate. You say, but that's okay, I'm going home. They say, wait a minute, mister. So you get that $1,500. So now you can get this brand new Honda Accord for $4,700. Does that make sense? Make some practical choices. Use some wisdom when you make choices. And so just think about that next time you get ready to buy a car. If your car's running, if it's running and getting you to point A to point B,
yes, sir.
Say thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Hey, praise the Lord. And then you can move up. So live within your means and do that. 2 minutes. Talk about co-signing. I think that verse said enough, right? Basically, the interpretation of that verse you heard, if you co-sign with somebody, you done lost your mind. That's kind of the interpretation of that verse. Says it's a poor choice. Now, I know this is controversial. I don't want y'all to get on Facebook and attack me, because I know there's some mama's boys and some daddy's girls in the house. And I know some of y'all want to say, well, I got the cosign for my children. No, you don't. Teach them how to manage their money. And you don't have to. Now, if you want to, that's a good thing. That's an okay thing. But you don't have to. Teach them how to manage their money. You don't have to cosign. It's a bad thing. It's not wisdom to take on another man's debt. Another man's debt. And you're counting on them to make their payment, and then watch this. And then you fall out when they don't pay. You get mad and you don't speak. Well, that don't make any sense, because that's part of the possibilities when you agreed for the cosign. Are y'all listening to me? I'm done, Brother Jerry. So it really ain't right to get mad for something that you knew was a possibility. Because if it wasn't a possibility, they wouldn't have needed you to cosign. So if you can't forgive somebody for not paying, now they're not being honest and it's untrustworthy, all that stuff. I'm just saying, you knew the rules at the beginning of the game. If they don't pay, you had to pay. And guess what you did anyway? You cosigned. So stop whining and just go make the payment. Or don't cosign, or take the car. It's my car now. So that's just some very practical things today. Nothing deep, just some very practical things today. When can you owe money? When is it proper to borrow money? Because the impression could be from today's message, a lesson, that you should never borrow money. And the Bible clearly says it's not the best thing to do. But let's face it, we have to do it sometimes. So we're not being unrealistic. Well, they say that you borrow money for when you're buying a mortgage or education or business. Borrow as little as possible and pay it off as quickly as possible. These concepts may seem hard and counterintuitive to the popular culture, but remember, Philippians 4:13 says this: I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Finally, for some encouragement, let's listen to a great testimony from Doug and Colleen Allen. Last video is 3 minutes long.
Hi, we're the Ag. This is my wife Colleen, and then Mia and Noah. Well, Colleen and I were newly married, and we weren't really plugged into other couples or really involved in our church. But I saw this advertisement for the study, and it really interested me just because it had to do with money. I liked money. We didn't really have any at the time. It was like in the first week or two, the study asked us to list out our debts. With our car loan and our student loans, it came to $109,000. So I was pretty disappointed at that time. I was disappointed, I was embarrassed. I just kind of felt defeated.
For me, I really wanted to be a stay-at-home mom. So I had already been thinking, how am I going to stay home with $109,000 in debt? Like, this isn't gonna be possible.
I learned in the study that we have a part just as God has a part. So I was leaning on Him for His part. And then my part was also to work hard, where I needed to work extra jobs. I was working 2 and 3 jobs. Colleen was working during the summer. We went without cell phones for the longest time. And then when we finally got one, we got one and we just shared it. You know, we didn't have cable. We just lived very simply, but we still had fun, and we had to just be creative with fun. And it was really neat to see, just to take a step of faith and to tithe and to give, and just to see God bless that and to Him multiply that by just giving me skills or giving me extra jobs in order for us to attack our debt.
We had been married 9 months, I think, when we completed the class. And at a year marriage, we were looking to buy a house. And it was like God had put the floor plan in my head of what He wanted me to have. And I walked in, and The place had wall-to-wall carpeting, the kitchen, everything. It was bright red. The walls like had grease stains on it. It had a really bad odor in it. But I was like, I love it. It's perfect. And so we ended up, you know, buying the house, and because the mortgage was so low, we were able to just throw everything into our debt. The mortgage was so low, it was cheaper than us renting. That's how low the mortgage was.
It took us 7 years to pay off our student loan, our car loan debt. And then after that, 5 years later, we were able to pay off our townhome that we live in today.
One of the things we do right now in showing our children how to handle finances is we take out cash. And that's, I think, a tangible way to show our children that money comes from somewhere. You know, we're not just swiping a card, but that there's a limited amount, and whatever's in here is what we can spend. And when it's all gone, then, you know, we don't have any more. And so we want them to realize that they can make wise choices and they can plan ahead.
The other day I took my four-year-old to an NBA basketball game. In leaving the game, there was two gentlemen that looked like they were in need and came up to us in the pouring rain as we're trying to get into our car, and they just asked, you know, do you have anything? Do you have any money that we could have? And that's not something that normally I would just give, but I thought it was a really good opportunity just for my four-year-old to see me, and that's what I was thinking. I was thinking about her and just not hesitating and just giving to these men. And I don't know what they're gonna do with it, and I wasn't worried about that. I was just thinking about my four-year-old and just trying to show her off a heart of generosity and just living out generosity in front of her.
Let's pray. Gracious God, our Father, we thank you for the information that we were able to hear and share today. I pray, oh God, that something so practical can become real in our lives. I pray for families today, singles and couples alike. I pray that they might prosper, that every person that and every family that's connected to our church, the Point Church, I pray for their prosperity. I pray for their wisdom. I pray that the truth of your word will be real in their lives. We love you, God, and we thank you for the simple things, for the ability to come to church and to learn how to make our financial lives better, because you are concerned not about just our spiritual well-being, but our total well-being. We commit it to you. We love you and we thank you, God. I pray that they would embrace this course and that they will make the life choices and life changes that's necessary, that they might have peace. Give us all a heart of generosity because of your love. We thank you and we ask these blessings in Jesus' name. Amen. While the praise team is coming, can I tell you something?